more healthy about which people really understand about your mistakes. And it's enough about motivations and where you're coming from and why you're doing it and what you're doing. And it has to be perfectly honest, not all of that is going to disappear because of one reason you're overseas.
Yeah.
What are you going to do?
John, I've been working on several projects, and I share with you the situation, which I felt ever since I first got into the newspaper, the C.I.A. question, of being something isolated from the movement in the United States in whichever direction it happens to be, before the CIA or against it. But there have been good reasons for having stayed out of the country during the period that I lived out there. And I think there's still good reasons right now to stay away. But in any case, what I'm trying to do is work on two or three or four different projects. What I'm mainly concerned with is the writing of that part of World War II history, about the first World War II history, which is the clandestine side of American foreign policy. And this is something that could occupy a person for a whole life. In fact, it could occupy a whole university, because the clandestine intervention in the affairs of other countries, which has gone hand in hand with the overt and acknowledged foreign policy, has been just as important, and has, in some cases, maybe even been more important. But I'm trying to work on a second book now, which I'm co-authoring with Steve Reisman, on different countries and regions, and different stories and cases of major interventions by the CIA, secretly, in other countries, starting in Western Europe, and Eastern Europe after World War II, contributing in a large way to the development of the Cold War of the 50s and 60s, and then proceeding on into other regions and countries and coming back into Western Europe in a major way in the late 1970s in Spain, Portugal, Italy, Greece, the southern tier particularly, and France, of course, where left tendencies are gaining in strength. These are essentially the, this is essentially the major conflict. In addition to that, I've been working also.
What you're saying is that the history that people are going to find out about is very different than the history that's in the books now, as people are going to perceive.
Yes, it depends on the person and it depends on his understanding.
If most people.
Yeah, most people, for certain. Take, for example, yeah, I just want to say, for example, on Cocoa first. If you read Cocoa and on the post war period, you see practically nothing about the CIA interventions, the secret operations, the covert action, the Congress of Cultural Freedom, for example, the intervention in trade unions, student organizations. What has to be written, I think, is the history of the secret side of American foreign policy. And it's not just America, but it's Britain, British security forces, and other countries which participated. Which would go hand in hand so that people know their own histories in these countries, Western Europe and the Third World.
It will make a difference, I assume, about how people feel about it. Are they going to think people are going to be shocked and all that kind of
thing? I don't think people will be too shocked. It's again dependent on the conversation, but in the United States, I have a feeling that a lot of people. With all the revelations that have occurred in the general atmosphere and paranoia for the things approaching from the other, that developed over the last 10 years in the United States, people were so early on, I figured that part. But these are all operations which occurred and I didn't participate in, especially on the newspaper lines, but which I knew about peripherally, and which can be used precisely and written up as multiple topic on that history. But there are a number of other projects too, and in fact, that particular work also provides the basis for a whole period of film on the same subject matter. In other words, if I can, honestly, can write this up as a book with, say, 12 to 14 different chapters on different episodes to show how the same mechanisms, the same methods are used from country to country, what we can also do in audiovisual. And I think that
you can make a great book about that. The CIA body with a monkey and a funky little hotel and then the beach with a lot of cast.
Well, you can do the remote part, you can also do the documentary stuff. Or you can combine the two of them.
Yeah, yeah.
So, the most possibilities is there to try to show or to educate. Secret value of foreign policy has been, it goes along with the overt side, and it's also reflected on the domestic policy.
We're kind of getting into the media a little bit. Do you feel cut off in the other way as an American institution, at least that it's in terms of the foreign policy, and do you feel cut off in the media?
Yeah, very much more. But I generally have been able to say, to participate there, and that really is the place I have to be. If a person is concerned with American matters and his own country, I mean, obviously, I have to be there, but I have to recognize at the same time as I did when I first started the film. And once I go back there, I'm going to be subject to very considerable activity on the part of the organs of government, the FBI, the courts, the DNA, all of those things that probably could be used for terrorizing, to inhibit, to cause me to be disrupted or delayed in what I'm trying to do. So that's why I wanted to stay here in Britain in order to get this second book project out of the way, and several other projects which I've been working on at the same time.
What would happen to you if you think, what do you think would happen to you if you would never do science
today? First of all, I'd have an injunction to come here, and I'd have to get the CIA's permission, probably any statement that likely I'd be working at the agency. And in addition, they might just try to prosecute me. Four of having written a book I wrote, for instance. Yes, the same section of the law they apply in the military case, and that doesn't apply the passage of secrets to a foreign power. It's simply giving local public secret government information. Mark Wolf, my lawyer at the American Civil Liberties Union, doesn't think there's any chance that they could get convicted. But even if they prosecuted and tied me up in the courts for a year and a half, the experiments I would be tremendous and also the timber. More importantly, we have to decide whether we want to work on anything but the person for the period of year.
Since we always have to not be able to see. Fundamental justice department, what would your reaction be if it came back, if you came back? Their reaction is that they would say,
Right. They said that I haven't been indicted for anything more than 2 years after I went to college. And let's say it would be over 5 years after I went to Cuba for the first time. But it doesn't mean they wouldn't try to indict and prosecute once they were back there. But they won't say, you're right, they're trying to keep you from going back there.
And they could indict you in the United States now if they wanted to. But I feel like the text is all about the British Army or the group because to like the gender or any balance of everything. So, if they wanted to indict you, and there was a qualification that they couldn't write
it. Yeah, the fact that they don't is that they don't want to take it.
Yeah. But the injunction against the right intention of the domestic abuse is clear, which is sort of.
Yeah, it means that this book I'm writing is rising with the jeopardized and the films will be jeopardized. It means another book with one I've participated in. I don't know whether this will be directly affected, but helped work on another book that I've written an induction to. I hope it's published here in 1976, which is a book on the CIA in Europe called The CIA in Europe, Who's Who and What They Do. It is a series of stories on current and recent CIA operations in Europe. Such as in recruiting and lifting of these places there, and then the recruitment of Sweden, for example, of the journalists. A Kenyan journalist who was located in Stockholm and whose cousin had been arrested and was being tortured in Nairobi by the Kenyan security service at the CIA's request in order to get a handle over the journalist living in Stockholm. Because they wanted to send him to the bank, to Angola, to collect information back to it during the civil war in Angola. But anyway, this book was, this is a series of stories, it's all prepared for this book. But it also had, as a second section, besides the stories, a section on biographies, which starts with date of birth and place of birth and continues on through education and whole career program. Of over 500 CIA people, who have been the subject of the various revelations of CIA people all over Europe in the past year, for instance, the Welsh community. Yes, and all the 500 people. I have felt very tentative about any trip I might make to Eastern Europe or the Soviet Union because of the implications, because people would say, in May or so of 1975, the novice correspondent in London, my hundreds of others, asked me for an interview. And of course, I does it. And he took that interview at his place after a Sunday dinner, I think. And then he went off to the Soviet Union to pass his vacation there in summer of 1975. And he called me back at the fall and called me and said he had the clippings and wanted to continue if I was interested, then he would be glad to read them to me in English because they were the interview published in 2 or 3 newspapers and so he was going to want to explain them before he wouldn't. So I went to his place and he explained it to me. But at the same time, he earlier had agreed to try to see what the possibility of publishing the book in the Soviet Union was. And he came back saying that they were interested in the book published. Well, I suppose in the late 75 and early 76, I may have spoken to him twice, or three times, I don't remember exactly. Because first the Soviets were going to publish, then I got a letter from Progress Publishers in Moscow saying that they were not going to publish. Then he said again that they were going to publish. So there was a question of where they were in the world. And finally, in July of this year, they wanted to discuss the edition of the book with me. And I went to Moscow with my wife. And we worked for a week on shortening the book to the size or the length that the soldiers would be able to publish. And discussing commentary for all those. That's the beginning and the end of the Soviet connection.
Now, you as an exile, it was for the Wednesday curriculum and the topic. The point is that somebody probably didn't know about it, that that's an industry that you drive a lot of problems. Like, how do you feel about that?
Well, I made that a person in the opening. There was no secret about it. He called me by telephone and said, yes, I go by telephone. I assumed all along that the British border services were monitoring my telephone, probably his too, and that they would understand that it was an old and open company.
And it was a problem dealing with that kind of realism, because I mean, the other people have it. When you call up and you're like, somebody calls you up, and suddenly the bells ring in London, Virginia.
Well, you know, I had lots of contact with Soviets when I was in the CIA. I mean, one of my jobs was to cultivate KGB officers. So I never felt awed or hooked by the other side, by the KGB. And when the book was sold, documents, cases, which I participated, where the KGB was concerned. So, I look upon the career of Soviet officials as ordinary human beings, just like CIA people. And I didn't think that there could be any special implication if I were given an interview with the paper at the moment, if they were hosting Gaston, who knows what he was going to do in London. And if he were to try to push the publication of my book through the Soviet version of the universe.
I don't know about the correspondence that comes to visit me and one of these characters who's been named in the column of the KGB villain in the United States. I believe he probably is a KGB villain in the United States. It's going to be press agents. And I just told him, with the kind of work, the writing I do about the CIA, I don't want any part of you folks in the sense of doing any real kind of sense. And, it probably is better not to have that kind of contact. And he said to me, I'm leaving, kind of a slight, fly smile on his face. If I can be of any help to you in the future, Mr. Marx, you will call me on journalistic matters, of course. And, I felt I didn't want to get involved, and I assume you feel the same way.
Well, you may have felt there a certain inspiration that was uncomfortable. In my case, I had no occasion to suspect that he might have been an intelligence officer. Although, there are two ways to look at it. One, they might understand that it would be very improper for them to try to compromise me by sending an intelligence officer working on a commercial journalistic cover to try to interview me. I don't see that they would gain anything by that. While at the same time, they might feel that they'd better send an intelligence officer who would be able to handle himself better with an ex-CIA officer. I don't know. But in any case, there was no involvement coming to any of the meetings I had with him, which had been with a handful of them over that period of time. And in fact, it appears that they're going to publish my book in whatever short they need, we're trying to come up with.
They publish our book and they publish a chapter in publications.
Well, you know, the key to it is whether or not a person like me, as I said at the very beginning, can have a non-compromising relationship with officials of a country or with the publishing house of a country, which is, one of the major important countries in the world today. And it wasn't until that Morton Halpern, former Assistant Secretary of Defense, came to see me in London last year, I think, on his way back from Moscow, in a couple of weeks, I think, at the American Studies Institute, that I began to think that maybe I might be able to go to the Soviet Union too and not be compromised into some sort of relationship that would damage my credibility.
You know, people have been having established things that have been going on for years.
That's right, but those are establishment figures. What makes it more effective in my case is that I'm a critic of the system. So it gives them the leverage or the income they want in order to promote this story that there's some sinister, subversive KGB conductor, which just is
they needed that in the next newspapers.
They've been doing that for 2.5 years, and this most recent
crisis, which is my imminent deportation from Britain, is a continuation of the same campaign. And what is most interesting about the whole campaign is that it is completely unattributed. No CIA person or officer or employee has ever stood up and made the allegations. They have simply tried to focus them in a subtle way to susceptible journalists, Jack Anderson, who have published these as if they were the truth. But no CIA person has ever stood up and said it themselves, and certainly there would be no court action, which would be the normal procedure if, in fact, they had some potential that they had done with the Soviets or Cubans or some other country.
Newsweek said you got to drop in there and told everything you knew to it. Was it a Cuban or Soviet agent?
That was the first, that was the fourth story. That was in July 1974. It was just at the time when I finished my book, and when my name was about to come in connection with the Watergate scandals and the report of the Senate, the Irving Committee agreed with the Watergate scandals.
That's because you were the WH flag.
That's right. That was mentioned. They thought WH stood for Project Flight. For his thing. So they went back in
and what did it say for
Western Hemisphere Division of the WH.
And you were Western Hemisphere Division officer.
Yeah. And so I was about to come to the surface, even though my book was still 6 months away from publication. I was about to come to the surface in that context. And so the CIA decided they'd get in the first place. So they leaked this preposterous story about a former CIA officer, not Navy, at first, telling on a drunken disbanding to the KGB. And this was the way it was all over here in States. And my family in Florida practically. I mean, they knew that they must attach to me. And I called them right away when Victor Marchetti called me about the
Victor knew it was you because he had the same year also.
Yes, well, I was out in Cornwall. I wasn't reading newspapers or listening to telephones or listening to radios or anything. I didn't have telephones. But he sent me a telegram, and I immediately called him. He said, look, Phil, he said, they started. And he explained to me what had happened about the story. He said, my goodness, it's incredible. And he said, look, if you want to talk to a friend of mine from the Washington Post, he'd be glad to follow up and talk to him. And that was when Larry Stern came over to see me in Cornwall, and we spent 2 days together. And he went back and wrote a story. And then all of the media think
that you hadn't been drunk and you hadn't talked to a Soviet.
No, and they didn't say when, they didn't say where, they didn't say the name of the Soviet officer, they didn't say anything. It was just one of those very vague stories which, unfortunately, the American media stepped into and propagated.
And then the other charge that's in for you is that you spent considerable time in Cuba.
I did spend considerable time in Cuba. I lived there for 6 months,
which was
in 1971. I had been working on my book since early 1970, which was a little over a year after I left the CIA. And I had been turned down by five American publishers when I presented the book project in New York. I think they thought it was story.
They just said no what to think, because this was before the Pentagon Papers, before Watergate Papers.
And so they turned it down.
And they didn't believe you were a real CIA agent who were operative and wanted to unload his baggage to the world.
It's hard to say. I don't know why they turned me down, frankly. I was flabbergasted because I thought I had an important story. And I was just scared to death that the CIA would get wind of the fact that I wrote to write a book. And also, I was continuing to live in Mexico, which was the last country of China in the CIA. And I was very afraid that if the word got around in Mexico and I had been a CIA agent, I would just have had to leave. And that meant a whole domestic disruption.
Moving husband.
Yeah. And I wanted to stay living in Mexico. And I'd already enrolled in the National University of Mexico for a graduate program. And I thought eventually I'd come back to the United States to teach. In any case, I eventually, in early 1971, got support, or a pledge of support, and interest in here, from some of my friends. He's a French
publisher.
And I got made a proposal to him through a mutual friend in Mexico, who never wanted to be openly involved in
in case the publisher is still there.
Yes, Perot thought, and I agreed, that I could never get the book written in Mexico because they simply didn't have the research materials. I wanted to go back and reconstruct the events that had occurred in Mexico, Uruguay, Ecuador, and other countries. And other countries too. In order to show the CIA participation in those events. So it was a major research task to go back, partly with memory and partly with one document leading to another.
And newspapers.
Newspapers or something. So how was I going to do it? Should I go to the United States, for example, and try it? Already having been to the American publishers and expecting the CIA may have learned before then that I was doing this project. Or should I go to the cities in Latin America where I had served, where other operations had occurred, in order to research in the newspaper Morris, for example, or other places, what I needed? Should I go to Paris where I could be working with Maspero in New York? Or should I come to London? There are all sorts of possibilities. Maspero suggested that Paris might be, Havana might be one possibility because they did have research facilities there. And they have several documentation centers that might be of use.
And it was libraries that had the newspapers from Latin America.
They had newspapers and magazines and all sorts of other material which would help on the reconstruction of the events and on the general description of the realities. So I was extremely, interested in the possibility of the Cuban angle, because I had been to Cuba during the Batista era, before I went into the CIA,
as a tourist,
and I had lived in Latin America for the last 10 years, 11 years, and I had sent agents to Cuba to spy.
You had people you had recruited in Ecuador, Uruguay, whose purpose was to go into Cuba and spy.
They went there, I sent them there to spy, and they came back praising the Cuban Revolution. So I was quite fascinated by the possibility of going and seeing firsthand for myself. And I knew, though, that if I did go, that would give the CIA, when they finally found out, every reason to try to denounce me as having sold out much or being a turncoat, a traitor, a defector, all these things. And I had to decide then whether I would do it the really safe way and not go to Cuba, simply do whatever I could do in Paris or whatever city, or whether I should go, macho in Spanish, which means straightforward and all out, and go ahead and go to Cuba and hope that they agree, because what I had done was to tell Maspero that, okay, I don't want to go to Cuba to be a defector in the sense of both Soviet or Cuba or somebody else would be in the United States. I don't want to go through years and months of even years of debriefing. I don't want to get involved in counterintelligence ploys which would arise from the revelations that I might make. I don't want other people telling me what to do. I don't want to write a book for other people.
You didn't still want to be a speaker.
No, and I wanted to write the book for Americans, not for Cubans or for Soviets or anybody else. I wanted to write the book so that Americans, who at the end of the day are the only people who are going to stop this, would be able to get a knowledge of what the CIA is and what the CIA does, particularly the covert action interventionist operations, which serve to promote repression in many countries and cause terrible human suffering. So the Cubans accepted this version or this scenario, this condition. And I was never pressured by them in Cuba when I went. I went wondering, of course, and worried. But when I got there, it was serious, it was straightforward, and in addition to getting two university students to help me in the research at the José Martí Library, for example, at the Pacificus Americas, I also was able to travel all over the island and see different projects, which were just fascinating to me because I could compare the developments in the Cuban Revolution with what I had seen in Latin America for the last 10 or 11 years, and also what I had seen in Cuba in the Batista.
So what were the differences?
One of the differences were tremendous. You saw a
health program, which was serving the needs of the country. You saw no unemployment. I don't think you saw a tremendous labor shortage. You saw an educational system, which is it is very, very impressive, not only in the formal sense, but in the adult educational system. That is the night courses that everybody was taking. I also saw a lot of the economic development projects, such as citrus growing areas, such as the agricultural the agricultural projects such as rice growing areas and other cultivations, the efforts to create new and better herds of cattle according to the special needs of the tropical climate there in Cuba. I really did spend a lot of time studying these different projects and took a lot of notes. And in fact, infatuated by the idea of writing a book on the Cuban Revolution. At the same time, I also saw the failings, the disruption, which had been caused by the 10 million ton project of the year before, which had failed.
The sugar,
That's right. I also saw, for example, the long lines. They had a lot of rationing still. Restaurants, for example, you had to wait in line for long periods of time. You had to make reservations the day before. There were still grave problems that they were facing, and which people were accepting and working to overcome. So I thought that at least what I saw of the Cuban Revolution was very positive on balance. And housing, for example, was another major area of concern. And I could see for myself that the people were really participating, even though there was really a lot of hardship and aggravating things like standing in lines. But compared to what I'd seen in Latin America before, like in Mexico and everywhere, it was very, very significant. And while I was there, of course, the Pentagon Papers were surfaced. I had gone there about April, I think, of 1961. I think in June, the Pentagon Papers first came out. And I was given a tremendous jolt of encouragement by that. And did everything I had to do over a six-month period. You know, the odd thing is, John, that I went back to the United States after I'd been in Cuba. And nobody ever approached me. No one ever said anything. I had been in Cuba about 3 months, and I decided to go back to the United States to visit and be with my sons, who were with their mother in Washington. In August, I think it was. In July and August of 71. And I went back there. It's been about 6 weeks, I suppose, in the States. And I had gone to Cuba perfectly openly. And I had flown back under my own name to Spain and then back to the home ground. And apparently CIA didn't know anything about it.
But you know from your own CIA experience that those passenger lists coming into Madrid or coming into Mexico City were surveilled. I mean, you knew they knew.
Yes, I did. And I was so stupid for doing that. I thought, I was so desperate to see my children and to be with them that I did a stupid thing.
What difference did it make? I mean, why didn't you, as an American citizen, have the right to go to Cuba?
Well, I knew what they would think, you see, and I knew that they might be able to take, or I suspect that they might be able to take some measures against me there in the States. But as I say, I was I just didn't have a very good political criteria at the time, and if I had, if it were to happen today, I wouldn't take that risk.
But you obviously were impressed by Cuba. Shouldn't you, as an American citizen, have the right to go see positive economic development in Cuba or any other place in the world?
Well, of course. But again, there is this question of the fact that I'm so special having worked in the CIA. And I was writing a book, and if I wanted to get the book finished, I shouldn't have placed myself under the control of the people who stood the most to lose by the publication of my book. So, no matter what the reality was, I was sure that somehow the CIA and the government would concoct a way to release what I thought afterwards, because I went there thinking, oh no, I'll get away with it, which in fact I did, but it was absolute chance. course, when I went back to Cuba, then I began to think, well, the Cubans are going to think that something is fishy. Because they'll think, surely, if the CIA has been monitoring, as anyone would assume they do, people will come and go from Cuba. In fact, even in Mexico, they used to take people off planes and send them back up to the United States. But,
that's interesting. The Mexicans would take people off planes on the way to Cuba and deport them to the United States.
Damn right. They would, anybody flying to Cuba, when Cubana flying to Cuba, anybody flying to Cuba, had to be there about 3 hours ahead of time. And when they got there, they had to wait and fill out a card with all sorts of data, you know, place of date of birth and full name and all that stuff. And then that would all be phoned into the American Embassy, to the CIA. The CIA would then check all of their files against those people.
And run them through the computers.
Well, they didn't have computers. It was all done sort of manually. But in any case, the CIA was able to say, no, this guy shouldn't do it. And the Mexicans wouldn't let him do it. And they photographed everybody in the airport while they were waiting.
What would they do to the people who the CIA said shouldn't go?
Well, if it was American that they didn't want to go, they'd just bundle him in a car with a bunch of guards and send him back up and dump him across the border in Brownsville or in Laredo or someplace like that.
Do you know anybody specifically that ever happened to?
No, I don't. From memory, I'm sure I could find a case.
What kinds of people?
Americans who were wanted for some political offense in the United States, who may have had a been active in some sort of criminal activities in the United States.
Would somebody who was the enemy world and didn't talk to them?
That could certainly be, yes.
Did you know cases?
No, but now that you mention it, I think there may have been. There probably would. But I would expect that there are people who will remember that sort of thing.
The CIA always seemed disturbed about people and things like the Vince Ramos Brigade, non-American radicals who went to Cuba to cut sugar and things like that. I mean, what was your experience on that interview?
One of the things that impressed me most when I was in Cuba, in fact, probably more than everything I saw in Cuba, was the book Vince Ramos by the Vince Ramos Brigade. Because I could identify so closely. In Mexico, after I had left the CIA, I sort of became, I wouldn't say completely hippie, but I...
You got your hippie period, at least.
Yeah, I kind of got into that, and I drifted away from the convention and the conformity which was required of an American Foreign Service officer, CIA officer. I didn't, like we used to say years ago, go ape or anything, but I still had my little release. And
you were on the edge of the counterculture, at least.
Yeah, and I tried to join from time to time, too, but I mean, how does a former CIA officer join the counterculture? I would drive down to Oaxaca and get friendly with students, you know, bumming around down there, or wherever it happened to be, but I always felt a little bit of a fraud.
Because of your age, or because you came out of the CIA?
Well, after all, I was 33, that's not so old, but... because mainly I had this background at the CIA, and I couldn't be really honest with anybody.
In other words, if they asked you, hey man, what did you do? You
would say, I began to stumble.
What would you say?
Well, I'd say, I was a Foreign Service officer, I was in Agee, crap like that, which generally turned people off anyway, you see.
Mm-hmm.
And anyway, so by the time I got into Cuba, I was, maybe the Vince Ramos book jolted me back into reality because...
you had read it before you went to Cuba?
No, I read it when I got to Cuba. I found a copy someplace or somebody gave me a copy. And it was a series of stories written by the actual participants in the Vince Ramos Brigade. And I just gobbled that up. I thought it was the most wonderful thing. And I, at the same time, I was doing a lot of reading, like at that time, The Greeting of America, for example, was a bestseller. There was another book, The Age of Aquarius, from I think the name of Brady. There was also Philip Slater, The Pursuit of Loneliness. There were a number of books which I read at that time which had a really profound effect. the mafia story that was made into the movie, but The Godfather also. I mean, I did a lot of reading of, let's say, provocative books and fiction, which I hadn't done before, because I didn't have anything else in time in Cuba. I had a motorcycle, which they had given me, and it kept breaking down. So I was sort of stuck a lot of time out of beach house where I lived. And I'd take a bus into Havana or my motorcycle and see my friends in there. They'd come back out. I did a lot of reading. So the Venceremos book really had a profound effect. And I thought, boy, there is really a group of Americans who have their problems. I mean, you read the book and you see how they fight, and sexist and racist and all kinds of problems. But fascinating reading. So I dearly wanted to join that. I mean, I in fact, asked the kids, my friends there, if I could possibly go and meet the brigade, because they
the people who were down there cutting cane that year.
Yeah. Or if I could go speak to them and talk about the CIA, and it didn't work.
The Cubans didn't want you to see them.
No, they didn't want. Well, they were right, in fact, because if I'd gone there, and then it was sort of suddenly the story would have been out about the CIA guy working in Cuba. But I was terribly deprived of human contact. It was awfully lonely.
Yeah. So I mean, I suppose we should go off into the political thing. I mean, you essentially support the aims of the Cuban Revolution.
Well, it depends on which aims you're talking about. The social aims, of course, I would support, which is such things as medical care for everybody. Adequate housing, education system, the fact that the productive capacity and the distributive capacity of the country works for all of the people, that there isn't a small elite of the population which kind of festers and thrives on others. But, and also, of course, the unemployment. Cuba had terrible, terrible unemployment. Unemployment problems before the revolution. And they have been able to solve a lot of these problems. They have serious problems now, apparently, because of the collapse in the sugar price. And they're still dependent on, or largely dependent on, a monoculture. But at the same time, they have been able to create a spirit, a community spirit, or a national spirit, of sharing the hardships, which has really been the key to the success of the Cuban Revolution. And at the same time, they've been able to develop a certain independence in foreign policy, which is limited, but it's still an independence. And I don't know. I wonder really what would have happened in the United States, or what would have happened in Cuba, if the United States had not shown such terrible hostility toward the Cuban Revolution during the Eisenhower administration.
The Kennedy administration and the Johnson administration.
Yeah, but it really started in the Eisenhower administration. And started, remember, over the oil.
The nationalization.
Well, first of all, no, it's whether...
Oh, it was to refine
Soviet oil, as opposed to Venezuelan oil. And there were city service, Texaco, and I don't remember the other refinery, which refused. And then they nationalized those refineries and brought in the Soviet oil. And that was probably the most important event that determined the organization of the Bay of Pigs invasion.
But then, in other words, the United States government reacted to that, that what would turn out to be an expropriation and kind of moving closer to the Soviets by deciding that Fidel Castro would be overthrown.
Yeah, well, Eisenhower's poker partner was the chairman of city service, and I think he was eventually killed in a plane crash, but city service, I think, had one of the refineries in Havana. So you see a very intimate relationship.
And so the United States government, or at least the top level, decided they had to overthrow Castro.
Yes, because not only was the situation critical to Cuba, but the incentive or the tremendous influence that the Cuban Revolution had all over the rest of Latin America was just incredible.
People in other countries were impressed in some favorable way by what was going on in Cuba.
Yes, well, you have to study the history of Latin America to understand it, but, you know, when most of Latin America was liberated from the Spanish in the early 19th century, by 1825, every country was independent. And the United States backed it, backed the Wars of Liberation in most of Latin America.
Wars of National Liberation.
Well, in Cuba, it was a different story. In Cuba, the United States didn't want independence from Spain, because they realized that following the Haiti pattern, Cuba might become a refuge for runaway slaves from the south. And because of the great influence and power of southern politicians in the American, in the Washington government, the American support for Cuban independence never existed, never cropped up. And in fact, Cuba wasn't liberated. And in the 1850s, the United States offered to buy Cuba for, I don't know how many millions of dollars, maybe something like, something insulting like $2 million from the Spanish government, which they refused. And then later on, after the Civil War, and when the first Cuban War for Independence occurred in 1868, lasted for 10 years, the United States was very much opposed to it, because by that time, the United States of American capital had begun to invest in Cuba, in sugar particularly. And this long, or drawn-out war, which lasted on until 1878, was very detrimental to American investment interests in Cuba. So much the more was the case in the 1890s, when the Second War for Independence began in Cuba, independence from Spain, in 1895, when Jose Martí went there. And was killed, I think, within 2 weeks of the landing. But in any case, that war went on. And finally, the United States intervened in 1898, the British American War, which is what they call it, but it's really the Cuban Independence War, and took over the running of the show.
So Cuba became our colony.
Cuba became a colony and remained a colony until 1959.
Yeah. You didn't directly participate in the kind of the secret war against Castro, did you?
My participation was peripheral in the sense that it occurred in the countries where Cuban missions existed,
such as Cuban embassies.
Cuban embassies, yes. And my job was to try to penetrate those embassies through technical devices like bugging, telephone tapping, and also to recruit Cuban officials to betray the Cuban Revolution and to come over to our side.
He's fast with the CIA.
Right. I was very near to success a number of times in those types of operations. So I never sent any, I never, let's say, was involved in the Bay of Pigs invasion, but I did do considerable damage where the foreign missions were concerned. But in any case, this didn't crop up to my, this didn't come up and hit me in the face, in other words, when I went to Cuba in 1971.
What techniques would you use to recruit a Cuban diplomat?
It depended on what we knew about the diplomat.
You'd study them very carefully.
We would study them very carefully through telephone taps on their homes and on the embassy. And we would also get all the reports that we might have on this individual from other countries where he may have served, that is the Central Five. And we would look for all of the possible vulnerabilities of the person. For example, in one case in Uruguay, the Cuban code clerk had just, his wife had just had a baby, but for months he had been running around with an Uruguayan woman. And we thought that he might want to resettle someplace, perhaps in Argentina, with the Uruguayan woman and leave his wife, from a number of things he had said. And our principal source on this was not just a telephone, but it was the chauffeur of the Cuban embassy, who was in Uruguay.
Who was your agent?
Who was our agent working for us. And who had also become a very good friend of this Cuban code clerk. So we worked out a possible recruitment scenario, and in fact, it almost worked. It was, it worked at first, and then it didn't work, and then it was going to work again, and then finally, the thing. And that's, he told, he admitted what happened, and they sent him back to
the Cuban wasn't sure, even though he may have had some love for this woman, that he really wanted to be a traitor to his country and become a CIA agent, even though you were promising him money, a new life, and a beautiful woman, or something of that sort.
It's very hard to say. I never did understand quite what happened in this case, because it was quite irregular. And I think that probably if I had, during the early period, taken out $50,000 and given it to him, or showed it to him, at least, then he might have compromised himself completely.
Voted with his feet.
Yeah. But as it turned out, we voted with his dollars, I suppose. But as it turned out, I was cautious on it, and was being directed all the time by Washington anyway. That finally he decided that he just got cold feet, and he decided that he would just confess all and go back and spend 5 years on a correctional farm in Cuba and start a new life, which he probably did.
How did you feel about doing that to a human being? I mean, did you have any compunctions about it?
Not at that time, because I was, I must say that I was exceedingly cynical at that time. I was a very callous guy, and I just was insensitive. When you get into the CIA, it's very hard to explain. You have to be practically a psychologist or a psychiatrist to explain the attitude of a person. But you become arrogant with the sense of secret power. You become callous to other person's sensitivities. You simply become an operative who is calculating and cold, cool. So you look at things in a very inhuman way. And that's more or less the way I was looking at them then. I had come down to Uruguay at that time after 3 years in Ecuador. And I was arrogant and bold and simply a rather despicable person.
In other words, you weren't doing this to a human being. You were doing an operation.
Yes, and you detach yourselves from the realities. You detach yourselves from the personalities involved. You become something of a manipulator, an operator. I mean, you really become the American, epitome of the American rip-off, con man, and that sort of thing.
Have you ever felt an impulse to send letters of apology to any of these people? Or did you ever perhaps run into this guy in Cuba?
You'd be surprised. One of the, I've had a number of people that I mentioned in my book who were on the other side, not the agents especially, but the activists on the other side who bore the brunt of our operations have contacted me and have thanked me for writing the book. And one in particular who came to see me about a year ago and whom I saw a number of times since and did a number of film projects with, was Jaime Galarza. And Galarza was the president of the Ecuadorian Revolutionary Union of Ecuadorian Youth. And he spent long periods in jail because of us and what I was doing. And he wrote,
you got him arrested.
Oh, many times. And he was to us, one of the most dangerous revolutionaries of the period. He eventually wrote the most important book of the century in Ecuador. It's a book called El Festín del Petróleo, or the Petroleum Party. And it is a historical study of how the petroleum resources of Ecuador, which is now a member of OPEC, one of the great petroleum producers of the world, how these petroleum resources were discovered in the 1920s, more or less, and covered up. And Ecuador became a bad banana republic. And all of the poverty and suffering continued until finally it was needed. 1970s. They reopened the projects and then built a pipeline over the Andes, and the country became a great exporter. But Larson looked me up in here in Cambridge through people in London.
He's now in exile.
He has gone back, and he's politically active again in Ecuador. But he had spent years in prison there, a long time in solitary confinement. And I don't think that anything has been quite so gripping emotionally since I wrote my book as the times that I spent with him, particularly the first few hours of getting to know him, knowing that he had been on the receiving end of the operations that I had been doing, and that he had come to thank me for having written this book. I mean, it was a gesture. I can't describe how I feel about it.
Do you have that kind of forgiveness in your heart for people in the CIA? Could you forgive in that way?
Oh, absolutely. I would do anything I possibly can to CIA people who would want to, or who would consider even doing something to try to weaken the agency's ability to promote repression, to promote torture and assassination, and all the things that they do through their surrogate intelligence services and countries around the world.
They don't actually torture themselves, do they?
I never knew of any case, no. But they give the training, they give the equipment, financing, and everything from paper and pencil to automobiles
and weapons to them. And they know that the intelligence service that they're helping in Ecuador or Chile or Brazil is torture.
Absolutely. There's no possible way they can't know. I mean, John Horton, who was my chief of station in Montevideo, and I were sitting right in the chief of police office. He was an army general. And we heard right through the walls the moans and groans and screams of a man being tortured in the Uruguayan Police Department, the Montevideo Police Department, 1965. And it so happened, which to me was really a traumatic experience. It turned out that I had given the person's name to the police intelligence preventive detention, not expecting that he would be tortured.
And you would turn the name over as a representative of the CIA to the local intelligence services, which is part of your official duties.
Absolutely, yes, that's what happened.
But on a personal level, at the time, did it bother you?
Yeah, right. Probably at the time, yeah. I heard that voice. I mean, I still hear that voice.
Do you have guilt? Do you feel racked by guilt in any way? Or do you feel what you've done now is kind of made up for what you did before?
I don't feel too much guilt, no, anymore, because I think that mainly because of the tremendous acceptance and support and encouragement that I've gotten from people from country after country. Every place I go, I run into somebody who knows somebody who was in my book or whatever it happens to be. And the encouragement to keep on and to continue to focus attention on the CIA's work with other intelligence services, their promotion of repression, their secret subversion of the institutions of other countries. All of this encouragement and support more or less precludes a serious feeling of guilt. I mean, it's like being, like almost like never having worked with the CIA.
And you've got politics on it. Maybe you have a political commitment to the work you're doing.
Well, I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't do it if, obviously, anyway.
What do you tell us about your politics? I mean, what do you believe?
Well, I don't know. Why don't we turn this off for a second and we'll come back to it in a minute.
I'll just say for the record that was not a stop for Philip Agee to go off the record on his politics. It was a stop for both the interviewer and the interviewee to go to the
Let's see, how much time do we have to talk about politics? Not very much. Okay, make it quick, is this way. I think that what the CIA is doing is like pollution. It's polluting the political environment for future generations of Americans. And that where American security is concerned, in the long run, the support to the 21 families or the 100 families who control the wealth and income of a lot of countries together with the supports and security services, which enforce the prevailing social and economic injustices, is going to undermine, in the long run, the security of the American people. It serves the short-run security and the short-run profits of special interests, particularly economic interests of American companies. But I don't think it is the sort of policy that 100 years or 200 years from now any American would look upon with pride.
So you think societies in Latin America could be organized a lot differently on paper for that?
Yeah, I think American society could too.
Yeah. And how would you do that?
Well, I think there are many different ways. It depends on what the people are ready to take and accept and what people want. First of all, what is needed is a process of political, I suppose you'd have to say political education, or political development, whereby the fears which have been bred into us as a society from the very beginning, that is the sense of insecurity, the sense of having to struggle so hard against insecurity that we'd do anything to have a position of some influence or security, has got to be defeated. We have to learn to live. We have to learn to live or learn to accept the fact that we can learn or that we can live secure with one another. In other words, that there is enough to go around to satisfy everyone, that we can, in fact, have a decent life without ripping off our friends,
other borders,
and particularly other countries. But I mean, within the United States, talking about the domestic politics,
that sounds suspiciously like socialism.
I think that the trouble with terms like socialism is that they are emotive, and that socialism to so many people means people who don't want to work, welfare state, the people getting money for not working, that sort of thing. And I would say yes, socialism in the sense that where the major concern is in the welfare of the whole society,
more of the sharing
resources, of distribution, of all the things that go to make up the human needs of society.
And your means to getting to that, I mean, the people say you're a radical socialist. I mean, do you feel that armed revolution is the answer? Do you think we can peacefully evolve there, or is it going to be a combination of what?
I don't know, really. I, having not lived in the United States for so long, I can't tell what it is that would be best or people would want and all that. I would think that probably the approach would be first, education, as I said before. First, to show people that there are enough resources going around, that we don't have to be that much far ahead of our neighbors to have a sense of accomplishment in life. And that it's in everybody's best interest. Certainly, you see the hatred of the United States all around the world today. Everywhere you go, people are commenting or tied into the movement again. The point is that you can't force change on people who are not ready to get, ready to accept it. And I think it's anybody would agree that it's a mistake to try to force revolution or force socialism onto a society which is not ready to accept it. The fact is that once the fire begins to burn, then people begin to realize what the possibilities are. And then a lot of violence sometimes occurs, as in Cambodia recently and many other societies before. But nothing is going to happen until people are ready to accept it. So if people are ready to accept democratic socialism in a mixed economy right now, then I'm all for that. And I would do anything I could to help promote it in the United States, to support it. I'd vote for it, I'd speak for it, I'd write for it, and everything else. I also can see beyond that the possibility of a society in which there isn't any private sector to speak of. But this is something long far into the future, because it is a whole culture and political development, which takes sometimes hundreds of years to occur. And I don't believe in trying to force people at the point of the sword to change their ways overnight.
So you said more like a revolutionary socialist, in the sense that, say, a revolutionary socialist with theoretical base that need to be implemented tomorrow.
I don't have any theoretical base because I simply have not done the study. I don't know the history. I don't know all the figures and the different political views and all of what goes into sectarianism. Enough politics today, whether it's the United States or Europe or any other country. But what I do feel is that there has to be a very humanistic approach to the change so that a minimum of human suffering is possible, even among those people who are the worst exploiters. I mean, after all, I come from a very privileged, even latest home life, education, background in the United States. And so, of course, naturally, I went into the CIA. It wasn't any unusual thing in those days, having been a product of the McCarthy period and the Cold War. The CIA was known then for what it's known today. So you can't hold that sort of education against people and inflict pain on them because of their having been a product of those periods. But at the same time, I think that every encouragement should be given to create a more just society, a society in which people are not at the sword point of terrible insecurity and want in terms of food, in terms of education, children, housing, better prepared, those sorts of things. And this is why I see that I think socialism without any doubt comes in the United States, but it has